The scientific evidence on the absence of the expansion of the universe was presented in great mathematical, physical, and experimental details at the International Workshop on Astrophysics and Cosmology for Matter and Antimatter, held at the Republic of San Marino in the northern Italian peninsula from September 5 through 9, 2011. Professor Santilli will now outline the main scientific results achieved at the 2011 San Marino workshop during the session on matter.
All primary lectures of the 2011 San Marino workshop on astrophysics and cosmology have been filmed and they're available for free viewing in at world-lecture-series.org. This is the last link in the main page. Ladies and gentlemen, I have dedicated my research life to the study of the so-called interior dynamical problem. It consists in achieving a mathematically rigorous representation of extended particles and electromagnetic waves propagating within physical media. By comparison, the exterior dynamical problem is referred to the point particles and electromagnetic waves propagating in vacuum. Now, the entire 20th century theory has been developed and tested and verified for exterior dynamical problem. So the interior dynamical problem is essentially unknown, was essentially unknown at the time when I initiated my graduate studies in the mid-60s. Now, the difference between exterior and interior dynamical problem is rather dramatic. Here is a picture of a satellite during re-entry in our atmosphere. Therefore, this is an interior problem. When the same satellite orbits in vacuum around the Earth, that is an exterior problem. Now, the biggest difference and most visible one in regards to interior problem is that they are irreversible over time, namely that their time reversal image violates causality and virtually all other physical laws. So, but in addition, the interior problem cannot be represented with 20th century theory. Technically, they are variationally non-self-adjoint, do not admit a Lagrangian or a Hamiltonian. So therefore, when I initiated this study, this was an intriguing problem indeed. I initiated this study because of very interesting industrial applications that eventually have been developed. When I started this study, my PhD supervisor told me that, Ruggero, the problem that you are interested in studying does not exist. I said, why? His answer was that because when you have an irreversible system such as this one and you reduce it to elementary particle constituents, then all the reversibility disappears, so he said, and you recover full reversibility in Lagrangian and Hamiltonian and so on at the level of individual particles. Ladies and gentlemen, I did not accept this view 50 years ago. I do not accept it now. Why? Because it is an excessive approximation of reality. It is made for the specific unspoken intent of recovering conventional theory, Einstein and quantum mechanics at the particle level. But the implications are excessive for me to accept. For instance, this posture implies that the entropy does not exist, is illusory, that the physical law of thermodynamics are illusory, because when you have a thermodynamical system with an increasing entropy, you reduce everything to elementary particle and all this disappear and you recover nice Einstein theories and so on. Ladies and gentlemen, in view of this, I proved a number of theorems. The first of this during my PhD studies, then later have been republished in various referee journals around the world. One of them states that an irreversible macroscopic system such as this one cannot be consistently decomposed into a finite number of elementary particles, all in nice and cozy reversible conditions. This theorem can be proved by first-year graduate students, therefore establish the political character of the posture. I put it organized. Because when I came to America, I discovered that it was widespread all over America. It still is, as of today, because of the politics surrounding basic research. The reality is that this theorem, no reduction theorem, established that irreversibility that you see here, not only does not, cannot disappear when you go to the elementary particle, no way, not on serious scientific ground. Not only does not disappear, but it originates at the most elementary possible level of nature. stated in plain words, Santilli no reduction theorem established beyond credible doubt that special relativity and quantum mechanics have limitations. They must have limitations. They were conceived for reversible system, namely system of what the time reversal image is also causal. And for those systems, they are magnificent theory, but they are inapplicable, and you cannot say violated. It would be unethical to say violated, because Einstein did not conceive this theory for irreversible system. Manipulators of science extend Einstein idea and abuse Einstein name under condition he never intended for. During my PhD studies, I also achieved the highest possible knowledge of mathematics to be a serious theoretical physicist. So I went to the very, very root of 20th century theory, and I discovered that they can all be reduced to the most fundamental mathematical tool known as Lie algebras, or Lie theory, or Lie product. It's AB minus BA. Think about matrices or integral differential operator, whatever. Then I discovered that the origin of the reversibility of all 20th century theory can be reduced to this invariance of the Lie product, namely the invariance und anti-hermeticity, minus the Hermitian conjugate. It was then evident, we're talking about 50 years ago, it was then evident for me to achieve, to at least initiate studies of irreversibility, I had to break this invariance. And indeed, I did. I introduced the PQ deformation of Lie algebra in 1967. I repeat, 1967. And it was published in a journal of the Italian Physical Society. And this algebra turned out to be Lie admissible. Then when I reached Harvard, later on in the late 70s, I achieved the most general possible formulation of Lie admissible algebra. And by using this structure, I proposed a covering of quantum mechanics under the name of hadronic mechanics. The literature on hadronic mechanics, after 50 years, I'm told, has surpassed the mark of 20,000 pages of publications in three continents, including, I don't know, 30 or 40 post-PhD monographs, not only by me, but various scholars, 2,000 or 3,000 papers, 40 or so international conferences, over 100 volume of proceedings, and so on. It's all available in free PDF download in our website. Let me close this segment by bringing to the attention of the American taxpayer some financial consequences of this general posture at the highest physics department in the United States of America, that irreversibility is an illusion that can be eliminated by going to the level of elementary particles. The best illustration is by looking at this huge particle accelerator built at CERN at the cost of about $2 billion. What is this accelerator for? Well, it accelerates protons almost close to the speed of light. And now, it is known, and I would like to confirm to avoid intentional misrepresentation of my presentation, that during this acceleration phase, the validity of special relativity and quantum mechanics, therefore relativistic quantum mechanics, is beyond any doubt. And in fact, this machine works because it's been designed with relativistic quantum mechanics. This is not the issue here, because this acceleration, during this phase of acceleration, the system is reversible. So therefore, 20th century theory apply unequivocally. The politics initiate when the proton leaves the accelerator, hits the nuclei, and produces a shower of particles. Then this process is manifestly irreversible over time. Irreversible. So we have the transition from a reversible process to an irreversible one. Question. Is special relativity and quantum mechanics and relativistic scattering theory still exactly valid here? The answer, ladies and gentlemen, absolutely not. Indeed, because it does not has no account whatsoever of the irreversibility of this process. And here are now the financial implications. This accelerator was built at the cost of $2 billion. For what reason? To look for a particle, the so-called Higgs intermediate boson, also called by them the God particles. I don't know why. Now, after spending the $2 billion, this particle has been disproved. It does not exist. But the point is the following, that a fellow taxpayer has to know, that decades ago, we knew that the Higgs particle could not exist the moment you take into account the irreversibility. Indeed, it is even recently at the 2011, January 2011, international conference in readmissible formulation that we had at Kathmandu University in Nepal. We presented five papers with a total of a couple of 200 pages or so that review this whole situation in extreme details and establish the reason, establish that the moment you include irreversibility, the X particle cannot exist. However, the price to pay for this type of political conduction of basic research is very grave for us. I have heard many times during my travel around the world, lecture, participation to meeting, the very unfortunate, very painful dubbing for me that America is the great scientific Satan. Why so? Because of the manipulation of basic knowledge for personal interest along quantum mechanics and Einstein theories. Unless we reverse this trend, I'm afraid that that dubbing will establish itself in history.
The most important contribution, in my opinion, with a direct impact on new technologies, new physics, and new chemistry, is the generalization by Professor Santilli of Newton, Hamilton, and Schrödinger equations, because many phenomena that happen in the world are not relativistic and have to do with these above-mentioned equations.
The readmissible covering of 20th century theory is excessively complex. To give an idea, only a few mathematicians in America know in details, technical details, what the readmissible algebra is. Therefore, at the 2011 International Workshop on Astrophysics and Cosmology in San Marino, we studied a subclass of interior problems, those in which we ignore irreversibility in first approximation. What does it mean in practice? Well, consider these electromagnetic waves propagating in water. This approximation that we consider in San Marino was essentially to ignore the dispersal of light, so that the intensity of light here can be also located here. Now, as you can see, it is not a major loss of intensity, so therefore this approximation of interior problem restricted to reversible system, but still interior, is indeed viable. Now, before we enter into review of what happened at this San Marino workshop, we have to denounce the politics in the field. Now, the first one is the following. Albert Einstein discovered that certain frequency, not all frequency, no, it was very clear, Albert Einstein was Albert Einstein, certain frequency of light are absorbed, and this absorption is quantized. Even though he didn't believe in quantum mechanics, but he discovered it was quantized. He called this absorption photons, and he justly obtained the Nobel Prize. Now, in view of this success, throughout the entire 20th century, Einstein followers have reduced all electromagnetic waves to photons. Why so? Because of the unspoken, this is the insidious part, for the unspoken intent of maintaining the validity of Einstein theory also in interior condition. So, you see, in water, you cannot even define Einstein's special relativity. You cannot put inertial reference system here. In water, you have an electron traveling faster than the speed of light. The relativistic sum is violated, etc., etc., etc. So, to recover Einstein, so they organized the interest of Einstein, say, they reduce light to photons. The idea is that photon will scatter through the molecule of the water at the level of the photon that propagated in vacuum. They claim to recover Einstein. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a manipulation of scientific knowledge that has been proven in many referee journals to be such. Why so? For many, many reasons. First of all, you cannot reduce to photons an electromagnetic, a radio wave with a meter wavelength. Come on, there is a limit of indecency beyond which we lose our face. Even at the level of infrared, infrared propagation and absorption is not quantized. So you cannot reduce all electromagnetic waves to photons. And all electromagnetic waves have the same phenomenology in interior condition, all of them, not only certain. Number one. But even a first-year graduate student can see that the moment you reduce to photons this incoming light beam, when the moment the photons hit the surface of the water, they will scatter in all directions. There is no possibility whatsoever, none, that the light beam can bend in this way. None. Show me the vacation. It does not exist. But that's the beginning. Then we go, when we propagate here, then the reduction of the speed of light is about 1/3. It's huge. It's a reduction of 100,000 kilometers per second. It's a huge reduction of speed. If you reduce this light to a photons, you can at best scattering among the molecule. You can at best represent 5%, 7% reduction of speed. But it's still at the surface of the enormity of the manipulation of science. Then, because, okay, then you know, to represent this light beam propagating along a straight line in water, you must have an enormous number of photons penetrating inside an enormous number of nuclei and going through without any scattering whatsoever. Ladies and gentlemen, again, there is a limit in this type of manipulation of science in which we Americans lose our dignity, let alone we lose our credibility and we lose our leadership in the world. This is one of them. The reduction of light beam propagating within a physical meter to more photons is a scientific scam and has to be declared as such. But this is only the beginning. Another one that has been announced very strongly is what you have, virtually everybody has heard at all levels of society, has heard many, many times, namely, quote, the universal constancy of the speed of light. Universal constancy of the speed of light. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a political statement, not a scientific statement. Albert Einstein stated the universal constancy of the speed of light in vacuum. That's a scientific statement which has been proved rigorously, mathematically, and verified experimentally. Why the moment you remove the words in vacuum, you do politics, and has to be denounced as such. Because the unspoken intent in removing the word in vacuum is to imply that the speed of light is universal everywhere, including within physical media. And therefore, for the unspoken intent to maintain Einstein for chairs, money, and several other reasons. In reality, the speed of light is a local variable. Depends on the medium in which it propagates. And we know that the only possibility for a serious scientific a numerical representation of the bending of light is the decrease of the speed of the electromagnetic waves, not photons. The speed of electromagnetic wave conceived according to Maxwell as well as Lorentz as being a transverse oscillation of the ether. When I was at the Department of Mathematics of Harvard University in the late 70s under support from the Department of Energy, I confronted the following problem. To achieve a mathematical representation, including most of all a geometrical representation of interior physical media such as our atmosphere, which are notoriously inhomogeneous because the density changes with the elevation, and anisotropic because the Earth rotates. It was evident that none of the mathematics available at the top of one of the best mathematical departments in America, the Harvard Mathematics Department, none of the mathematics available there will provide a quantitative representation of this physical medium by keeping in mind the no reduction theorem. Cut the politics out, reduce this to elementary particle for political reason without a quantitative process. So I had to work out a completely new mathematics from the foundation. Due to the absence of any mathematics that will allow me a quantitative representation of interior dynamical systems such as, you know, electromagnetic waves propagating in air, then I had to work out a new mathematics that will, without a new mathematics, there was nothing I could do as a physicist. So after a number of trial and errors, I did indeed develop a new mathematics today known as Santilli isomathematics, where the word, the prefix as iso, is intended in the Greek meaning of isostopos, namely preserving the original axioms. So Santilli isomathematics is essentially not a new mathematics as far as the axiom is concerned. It's a new mathematics in the sense that it is a new realization of established and well-known mathematical axioms. And this new mathematics is based on the most general conceivable unit that can be realized by the matrix and integral differential operator and whatever you think. But from an abstract viewpoint, it has to be positive and definite. It's exactly the same as the unit one of the 20th century theory. So in this sense, the topological characteristics of the number one are preserved. I do not have time to review this new mathematics, but the entire mathematics of the 20th century used in physics had to be lifted in such a way to admit this new unit as the left and right unit at all levels. The literature in the field is so vast. Again, we're talking about tens of thousands of pages that have been written at the mathematical, physical, and experimental level. I can only flash a few. Let me look at the consequences of isomathematics. Well, the mathematics of the 20th century, that of special relativity, in particular Lie theory, if you want, Minkowskian geometry, characterized this space-time line element, which is very, very well known. But this is for the vacuum. Now, this isomathematics, which is directly universal, includes all conceivable, possible, inhomogeneous and anisotropic conditions that you can think of, arbitrary density, etc. They characterize this generalization of space-time, which since it is symmetric as well as non-singular, can be written in this form. You will recognize here an arbitrary speed, which is the speed c, the speed of light in vacuum, divided by the index of refraction. So basically, this generalized line element allows us to study the so-called historical Lorentz problem. Lorentz achieved the universal invariance for a constant speed. Here's the problem, is to achieve the universal invariance for an arbitrary speed. I did achieve this invariance, and the symmetry is today called Lorentz Poincaré Santilli isosymmetry. I did achieve it in a letter, one page, in a letter journal published by the Italian Physical Society. This was one page of the solution of this historical problem, but because I had spent 10 or 15 years in preparing all the necessary mathematics. This is the universal invariance. And as you can see, this is locally isomorphic to the Lorentz symmetry. And in this sense, this illustrates the isos topos, the preservation of the axiom. Also, I would like to stress that while my contemporary colleague, they generally and often abuse the name of Albert Einstein, Poincaré, and Lorentz by applying them under conditions dramatically different than those of the original creator, therefore abusing their names. My way of honoring their name is different. I honor Albert Einstein by keeping the axiom of his theory and showing that his axiom can be broadened to represent broader physical system. But the axiom remains the axiom, Einstein axiom. The symmetry remains Lorentz and Poincaré. I only produce a broader, the most a formulation, however, non-trivial, because it's directly universal. Has been proven by various independent authors being directly universal, will essentially provide an invariance of whatever interior dynamical system you can think of. Let's look at the literature is again too vast to quote here.
Santilli's new physics, based on his new mathematics and experiments, have surpassed the theories of Albert Einstein and his followers of the 1900s.
Now let's look at the consequences of this isotopy of special relativity, isotopy of the Lorentz-Poincaré symmetry. They are non-trivial, because in vacuum you have the Doppler law, which is well known. I don't have to repeat it here. Whenever you consider an inhomogeneous and anisotropic medium, then you have this generalized law that is today known as the Doppler-Santilli ISO law. It's essentially the one before, but you see the multiplication of the so-called characteristic quantity that multiplies the ratio V over C. And S is the space direction that you have selected. Remember, you are an anisotropic inhomogeneous, so the physics change depending on the direction you select. Good. But the key point is the characteristic quantity depends on the velocity. So therefore, the Doppler-Santilli isotopic law predicts also a shift of the frequency or the wavelength in the absence of any relative motion at all. And this is now known as Santilli iso redshift, in which case, when you have the minus there, in which case light merely releases energy to the medium. Generally, that we know now technically the reason why it has to be at low temperature. We also have the Santilli isoblue shift, in which light acquires energy from the medium, but has to be at sufficiently high energy. And then we have the no iso shift, in which the energy released by lost by light and the energy acquired by light, they are equal but opposite, and so you have no change of the shift. Following the solution of the historical Lorentz problem in 1983, I immediately worked at the physical implications. By 1991, they were all very clear. One of them was precisely the iso redshift. And therefore, I wrote two volumes. In one volume in the isomathematics and another volume on the physics. This was in 1991, regarding the iso redshift, as well as the iso blue shift and other. But I was primarily interested in the iso redshift. And so I proposed an experiment, namely to measure the behavior of the entire spectrum of sunlight in the transition from the zenith all the way to the horizon, and verify whether or not the redness of the sun at sunset as is due to this iso redshift or not. As everybody knows, the redshift of the sun at sunset occurs without any appreciable relative motion between the observer on Earth and the sun. The sun merely goes down, but the distance Earth-Sun remains the same. Well, since 1991, I proposed this experiment to virtually all major physics laboratories around the world to receive instant disqualification. Santilli does not understand physics and this type of dubbing. And why so? Because the mere consideration of this experiment implies departure from Einstein's special relativity. In my words, it implies departure from the 20th century limited realization of Einstein's special relativity, not the contemporary one, which is much broader, thanks to the isotopy. So after 20 years of rejection, finally, in 2009, I decided that I had no other choice than do the measurement myself. We had a fully equipped laboratory at the Institute for Basic Research in Florida. So I built this, what is today known as the IsoShift testing station. It consists of an air-conditioned cabin here containing the laser, and then another air-conditioned cabin containing the wavelength analyzer. And the laser and the analyzer are interconnected by 60 feet long steel tube. Then what I did? I measured the wavelength of the laser at under vacuum. This is the value. And then I measured the wavelength of the laser when there was air at 2,000 psi pressure in the 60 feet long tube. And clearly I saw, this was in June 2009, I clearly saw the verification of the iso redshift, namely a shift toward the red without any relative motion at all. Nothing moves in the iso shift testing station. Then I also proved that the iso redshift increases with the pressure. I repeated this measurement many, many times. Finally, in February 2010, I presented those results for the first time at a very, very nice workshop in Barcelona, organized in honor of Professor Elizalde. And then I published the result in the Open Astronomy Journal. It's a journal in which I am not an editor. These results were then reviewed at the San Marino workshop. There was a presentation by Gene West and Gino Amato of a one-year systematic repetition of my original measurement in 2009 that confirmed the iso redshift, the iso blue shift, no iso shift, the dependence of the iso shift on the temperature, etc. A beautiful lecture by Gene West and Gino Amato, a 2011 San Marino workshop, was filmed and is available in the World Lecture Series. I definitely recommend anybody interested in details in this experimental confirmation to view it.
The discovery of iso redshift is important not only on its own, but rather it represents the experimental confirmation of the validity of a whole new approach to modern physics suggested by Professor Santilli. For example, remember that the discovery of the laws of electricity and magnetism by Michael Faraday happened in the first half of the 19th century, It was a quite a revolutionary discovery, but it was realized in electrical engineering only at the end of 19th century. At the same time, it completely changed our global economy and all of our lifestyles. Such is the fact of any great physical discovery, and I am certain that the discovery of either redshift does in fact belong to such great discoveries.
First off, magnet gas uses a lot less oxygen than acetylene. If you notice, 1/10 of a turn on the oxygen. Now it's time for the true test.
It's now been documented and verified by the Institute of Ultrafast Spectroscopy of the City College of New York that magna gas has the hottest flame temperature known, reaching 10,500 degrees Fahrenheit. That's actually over 4,000 degrees greater than acetylene. That's the reason magna gas can slice through this 6-inch thick metal plate like nothing else out there. What you see here was a demolition job on the east coast of Florida. They had actually allocated 33 days to complete the job, and it turned out taking just 8 days using magna gas. Talk about a happy company. They've never seen anything like it before. So now the word's spreading throughout the demolition industry that if you want to save money and time, be safer and go green, then go magna gas. It's as simple as that.
Mi chiamo Carmine Nardone e sono il presidente di Futuridea, un laboratorio che si occupa di innovazioni utili e sostenibili. Ho avuto modo di conoscere il professor Ruggero Maria Santilli già da alcuni anni ed è stata una fortuna avere rapporti con lui. Ma soprattutto abbiamo apprezzato l'applicazione concreta delle sue ricerche in strumenti, in macchine che possono essere estremamente utili per il futuro dell'umanità. Vi sto parlando al Consorzio Aereo Industriale di Benevento, dove il primo impianto adronico per la trasformazione dei liquami in un gas super ecologico è stato installato già da circa un anno.
Americans must again begin to choose products made in the USA. Together we can change the destiny of our next generation. Choose wisely, choose magna gas. To set up your free demonstration and learn more about magna gas, call 727-934-3448 and visit our website, magnagas.com. Go green, save green. Magna Gas, like no other. Born and made in the USA.